Hey, good morning, good afternoon, and of course, good evening. I hope you're having a fantastic day, and have you had a cheeseburger today? Well, the reason I'm asking that is, of course, when you go someplace and you get a cheeseburger, or you get fish and chips, or you, I know that sounds gonna sound funny about fish and chips, but you order something and they say, would you like fries or tots with that? That's a no-brainer, right? Tater tots. Who doesn't love tater tots? So today, I have a very special, we'll make that two very special guests. And that is Steve and Leslie Grigg. So they are direct descendants of the founders, the inventors of the tater tots and the Orida brand. Well, what we're going to talk about today is the history of tater tots and how it really came about, as well as why we're doing this right now. So the Grigg family wants to preserve, you know, the family history, the lineage of where tater tots came from and the name Orida and everything. So we're going to learn a lot about that. In fact, I was told by some people that, you know, tater tots had something to do with Seattle, or Seattle had something to do with tater tots. So I asked both Steve and Leslie, I said, is that true? You're going to find out if it is or isn't. So stick around, and as always, thanks for watching and listening to this podcast. Let's get into it.
To me, I'm still in the advertising arena.
Okay.
Advertising and marketing, and I just work as a contractor from home.
Oh, Leslie, what do you do now?
Well, I retired in April. For the sole purpose of starting and running the Grigg Legacy Tater Tot Foundation. And I just retired with 45 years as a financial advisor, financial planner, stockbroker. I wore about five different hats in my career. But anyway, 45 years as a financial advisor.
Wow. Well, you know, the nice thing is all three of us are working from home now.
My first passion was the stock market, and then I discovered I need to adopt my family legacy of my first passion. So that's my career choice career going forward.
Yeah, you know, this is a perfect jumping board to get right into our discussion today of the Grigg family and Orida and how everything got started and why you want to carry on this legacy. And I'd like to find out if there's, from either one of you, you know, growing up and even now, there are challenges in doing most anything, and it takes some courage really to take that risk to retire, to pursue this passion, to stay in the advertising marketing game with the ever-changing, you know, platform of everything. Now you have folks saying, oh yeah, I could put that out for you in 5 minutes, and they go to ChatGPT or whatever it is. Here you go.
Between ChatGPT and Photoshop, I'm just about out of business.
You know, we're gonna have to mess with that algorithm and just put in a whole lot of wrong data for it to
yes,
pick up, and then we'll say, oh, that's no, that's why you need human intervention. So yeah, Steve, can we start with you, kind of just starting off?
Sure.
With the start of, well, it wasn't Orida right off the beginning, because you started off your father, right? It was your father and
my uncle, so his brother.
Like in 48 or 49 or something, they started off Sweet Corn, and then it eventually moved into Orida. So can you kind of touch on that a little bit?
Well, they are post-Depression babies. They were post-Depression babies. And post-World War II teenagers, and they were just really, really poor. And so being farmers, they knew how to farm. Mm-hmm. And it was a little bit, I liken it to selling, you know, refrigerators to Eskimos. They were able to, they picked sweet corn at night when it was cool. The temperature, the local temperature was very what's the word? Very, not
crisp.
Formidable. What's the word?
Crisp.
Well, no, it was crisp, but it was very friendly to crops, and so they would pick this sweet corn in the evening and keep it in ice water overnight, and then they would load it in a horse and buggy and take it around and sell it door to door. And that was quite a feat. And I think that as young teenagers, they were quite they didn't they did they had no fear, is what I would say. And they just said, we're going to do this, and here we go. And I remember one of the stories that my uncle Golden, so Nephi is my father and Golden is my uncle. So Golden had gone up to the door to this lady and given her the sales pitch, and she bought some corn. And as he was walking away, she said, "I really don't need this corn, but that poor boy looked like he could use the money." And we're talking about a small community, and just, they didn't wear shoes. They had one pair of overalls, that kind of a thing. And so that's how it started, selling sweet corn door to door. And as the more sweet corn they sold, the more the demand was. And it had something to do with, being in the right place at the right time, or just being industrious enough to take that on. And so eventually they had to contract with other local with other farmers to harvest sweet corn from them at night and put it in ice water and keep it till the next day. And that's how the sweet corn business came into being, and they just called themselves Grigg Brothers.
And by 1949, they were transporting sweet corn from Ontario, Oregon, all the way to California on the south, up to Seattle on the north, and all the way into the Dakotas on the east.
Before we go any further, I need to ask because I don't know, well, Orida came from because you're on the coast of Oregon and Idaho, right? Basically, the plant, is that how that the name came about?
Yeah, Orida was the name. That wasn't until later, and when they the whole story. They bought a defunct frozen foods processing plant that was in Ontario, and it was right on the river, and it was right on the railroad, so it was the perfect location. But whoever built it, what was it called?
Bridgeford.
Bridgeford. They didn't take into account the local economy, the local populace, the attitude of the people, and it didn't last. And so they were able to get that at a banker's auction, but they couldn't do it by themselves. They didn't have the money, and so they required other local businessmen, excuse me, and even farmers to go in with them to buy this plant. And so very much a community oriented process and success story. And so go ahead.
I was going to say, the reason I ask is, I brought this up to a number of people because you see Orida brand out there and it's so familiar. And I had mentioned Oregon, Idaho, and they're like, oh no, they're from Seattle. And I was trying to figure out how in the world did they get that Orida's from Seattle? So I just quickly wanted to bring that up and ask, was there a certain tie very, very early on where it may have confused people in the Northwest area? Do you know, or is that just because I'm asking the wrong people?
I don't know. I've never heard that. I've never heard it being confused with Seattle. I haven't read every article out there, but no, it was always on the Oregon-Idaho border. And my dad just came up with Orida. He thought that was just kind of a natural way to name it.
Yeah, Ontario, Oregon is about 10 miles from the border. Between Oregon and Idaho, it's a fact. That whole area, there's about six communities, and there's they all just consider themselves to be one community. They don't really identify them as which one's on the right or the left side of the state.
No pun intended on that one, right? All righty. All righty.
That slogan came much later.
Oh, well, it's yeah, it's kind of fast forwarding on this because, like I said, 48, 49 sweet corn, about 52-ish the Orida thing came in. But how did tater tots really come about, from sweet corn, potatoes?
Well,
from scraps? That's scraps of something?
Yeah, so what happened was they're first, as you know, they went through a naming, you know, a name evolution. Grigg Brothers, okay. Grigg Brothers Produce. Les, help me out here. Some other names, and eventually became Orida Foods. And the first potato product they put out was French fries. And of course, potatoes are round and French fries are square. And so they had these little shards, little slivers left over. And they just, you know, the potatoes were a premium product of theirs. And those slivers were sold at a pittance to feed one of the local farmers, sold to one of the local farmers to feed to his cattle. Incidentally, that cattle farmer was an investor in Orida, but they wondered, the Grigg brothers wondered, is there something better? You know, we're giving away prime potato product at a, you know, for almost nothing. And so the idea came about, and there's really no documentation of someone said, let's do this. My father was quite gregarious and was the president of Orida and generally has been the face of Orida and a lot of times gets the credit, but I can't really say that my dad did it or my uncle did it or whatever. But they decided that there might be a way to work with these. Could you chop them up, mix them with some spices, you know, and some cornstarch and a few other things. And at the time, convenience, so we're talking about the sort of the early 50s, mid 50s, you know, convenience foods, like I said, after World War II, I think the world was going through, at least the United States was, going through this sort of awakening of convenience. And they thought that there ought to be something they could do. And they came up with this idea to make a finger food, like a French fry, but only with those shards. And they Les referenced the... Holy, you got one there, Les? So there's a replica of what they lovingly called the holy board, H-O-L-E-Y. And it had different size holes. And they would make this mixture. They just called it a glop. And my uncle would shove it through one side and those little, you know, like Play-Doh, mm-hmm. and it would come out. My dad would cut them off and then they would fry them up and taste them and make adjustments to the recipe. But that prototype holy board was how that finger food, that convenience food came about.
That's, you know, that really is pretty amazing as far as taking, like you said, what would be junk or feed for whatever it might be, and then saying, hey, there's value in this. So
yeah, I mean, in one side of the plant they're premium French fries, and the other side of the plant it's cattle feed. There's got it. That's in, you know, that's an inequity right there.
And what's more popular now, at least, you know, for me, I'd say the tater tots has been out there for a long time, very, very popular with everyone.
Yep. Well, you know, a lot of people can make French fries. In fact, you know, J.R. Simplot and, you know, a lot of companies can make French fries. That's not a secret. But tater tots is only made in Ontario, Oregon.
At least the Orida brand tater tot.
Well, the Orida brand, excuse me. Thank you.
Yes. The Orida brand is only made in Oregon, Ontario, Oregon. One plant covers the whole distribution system.
For the entire planet.
Then and now.
Yes.
Correct.
That's pretty darn amazing. That really is. I get, do you know how many tons of tater tots are made annually or, monthly or anything like that? It's got to
I've
be.
seen some statistics, but I'm not sure. There's a lot of one-off brands of tater tots. There's tater gems and about half a dozen different names, but the Ore-Ida brand, if you look at carefully at the Ore-Ida trademark, the word tater tots plural is the registered trademark.
Okay.
Would guess that the figures that I've seen, somewhere around 70 million pounds.
We don't know if that 70 million pounds includes all of the one-off brands or not. I don't know
Sure.
that.
Something that I want to ask you to, Steve, specifically since you're marketing and advertising. I mean, this logo and just the name and the way everything looks, I mean, it's pretty darn fantastic. It's so recognizable. Do you personally feel that that's something that would be brought up or designed today that would succeed if it came out today? I know this is off the wall question, but
It's hard to say. I will say, as a designer, a graphic designer, they stayed with some iteration of the Oregon, Idaho logo for the last 70 years. Tater Tots turned 70 this year, and ever since Ore-Ida came into being, they've kept that logo. And I think keeping a logo intact over time is much better than updating it too much. Consumers get skittish if things change too quickly or too drastically. I remember my dad telling about the local ad executives from the big metropolis of Boise, Idaho. I mean, that was a big city to us back then. The ad people came over and they had all of these designs. I wish I could get access to those, but they had some ideas and everything, and it probably started with that Oregon, Idaho logo. And my dad reached, he looked at all that and kind of scratched his head. You know how self-made men are, self-made people, men and women are. They want to control everything. And so he reached into, he had a drawer full of crayons from when us kids came to visit. And he pulled out and he said, well, and he started scribbling on there. He says, I like purple. How about purple and yellow? Those two colors really aren't very appetizing, I will say. But that's how he did it. He just said, well, how about this? How about we do like this? And they were all like, well, yes, Mr. Grigg, certainly, Mr. Grigg. You know how ad men are. But what's interesting is that in the office building at the Ore-Ida plant in Ontario, the original office building, there's an image, and we can send you that image of the actual holy board that they had. And then there's a little fan of crayons that my dad used to do that scribbling. And then they sold Ore-Ida to Heinz Corporation in 1965, and then they have a little pen, little just a ballpoint pen that they use to ink the deal, and so that hangs in there as kind of a memorial to that incident. But nobody knows that's there, and it's very important. That's kind of what Les has started, is a way to make sure that the Grigg name, even though it's not Grigg tater tots like it's Hershey candy bars, but it's important that we keep the Grigg name associated with Ore-Ida for our and for our legacy.
Before we jump into that, I want to ask something, and I will preface it by saying I apologize if it's too personal, and feel free not to answer this. But like I said, it was Ore-Ida as the brand was sold to Heinz. Heinz at that time, now it's Kraft Heinz, for like I think they said $30 million, thereabouts. So
Why am I
sometimes
still
when you're
working?
Yeah, no. That's a good one. That's probably too personal. I won't ask that. You know, sometimes when money like that comes into family, there introduces greed. Was it difficult for your father and your uncle to really decide, you know what? Hey, we've got family here. What are we going to do with this? Are we going to give a little here, give a little there? How did that happen?
Well, so Les is my first cousin once removed.
Okay.
And so his grandfather is a brother to Golden and Nephi. And so, you know, being in the direct path of that $30 million, my father, I don't know what Golden did with his share. Mm-hmm. I mean, remember, there's all those investors had to be repaid.
Yes.
And so my father, he hung on to that for quite a while. And then he didn't divvy it out to, I'm one of eight kids. And so he had, the deal was for $30 million, but there was a lot of stock involved, a lot of mm-hmm. Heinz stock involved in that transaction. And so as the children, at least in my family, matured, he would gift stock options, you know, actual stock certificates to us. And the stock, you know, in the 80s and the 90s and stuff, it was great stock. I mean, it paid dividends and it would split. And I just kind of hung on to mine. And that was my father's advice. He said, now listen, don't play the market. Don't think you're going to get rich quick by selling your Heinz and investing in some high risk situation. Les knows more about the, you know, that concept. So I hung on to mine, and it would split and do things. And then as my kids went to school or when we needed a house or an education, I would sell that and use it. So that's all, you know, for my share and for my family share, that's how we did it.
Mm. Les, I like how you said, when we needed a house, we would. How many do you have? No.
I feel like I could break in here. My dad was, not only did my grandfather was the first production manager of Orida in 1952. Mm-hmm. He was also one of the investors in the original investors in Orida. He was one of the community people who helped start Orida just as an investor. My dad came along about 1959. He became a cost accountant for the corporation. And so 1952 all the way to 1959, Orida was really a family business. We had Golden and Nephi, who were brothers. Then their sister, Catherine, her husband, Otis, was the engineer for the corporation. He built all the equipment from scratch. And then my granddad, as I said, and I remember growing up, my grandfather would always talk about the stock that he had from Orida, and that became his retirement for the rest of his life.
And I'm hesitating because I'm trying to figure out how am I going to ask this and be professional about it and correct. So you folks grew up as LDS, right? Latter-day Saints.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So do you feel that at that time and even till today that there's more of a stronger community, so people were willing to help each other to build something? Do you think that played anything into it? Because it sounds like there's
that's an interesting question. I don't know how much to ascribe to just the local community,
mm-hmm.
The psychic that a local community has, but also local community was a lot of LDS people. So there was really close social ties, not only from the religious point of view, but just from the tight-knit community.
Yeah. I just bring
that
up because it's so important, and I think a lot of places and a lot of people have lost that sense of community. You know, even if you live in the community, it's people are so splintered. So I just I was curious about that.
Well, even though we're, you know, I'm in Salt Lake, Les is in Idaho Falls.
3 hours difference.
And we're spread out, and we have this connecting technology.
Mm-hmm.
You really can't beat a handshake. or in-person meetings. And so back then, everything was done in person. And you looked people in the eye and you did did your transactions and your farming and stuff like that. And everybody depended on everybody else. So there was no, as far as I can tell, there was no, get rich, rape the land, make a profit, and then bail. In fact, the part of the documentation of the sale of Orida was that the Orida name would not pass from the town of Ontario. Unless there's a phrase for that. Do you remember what that legal
In
term is?
perpetuity.
In perpetuity. And so even though Orida Food, Orida Plant, Orida Foods was owned by Heinz, and then as you mentioned, Chuck, Kraft Heinz, it's now owned by J.R. Simplot. But yet the Orida name and the Orida plant remain as they were. And so that was another aspect of the legacy that the Grigg brothers left for their little community.
I wish there's more of that going on. Which leads me to ask you, Les, is why such a strong pull or feeling or desire to turn this into a family legacy, whether it be, for yourself, for you and Steve, or to pass it along to your kids and then their kids? Is it just to letting them know that there's history to the family name, so there's a sense of importance, or is there something else that really is driving you to do this?
Well, one of the things is that Nephi and I are birthday buddies. We're both born on May 6th.
All right.
So I grew up basically grew up we had a every year we had family reunions, and my father and mother, they were dedicated to going to the Grigg family reunion, and I would go there, and at least every other year or two, Nephi would be there to tell stories, and I just loved his stories. He would sit on the back of a chair and he would just tell stories. And I can remember one event, and the story was told that he was going into a meeting with some high-powered business people in a board meeting, and he pulled up the chair, turned the chair around, leaned over to the back of the chair, and said, "Oh, hey, let's talk business."
And even though it was an aw shucks kind of approach, he had a vision. He had a vision of dealing directly with and looking with other businessmen and other possibilities, and just look at them right in the eye. I remember in Ontario growing up, at about the time of the sale, the Heinz executives would fly from Pittsburgh out to Boise in their private plane called the Flying Pickle. And it was a prop, it wasn't a jet or anything, but it was a prop plane. And we got to go to Boise and ride, fly around for a half an hour in the Flying Pickle. And man, that was big to me. Here comes the executives and their those businessmen in our backyard, and he cooked them all a big steak. We had a big steak fry in our backyard, and they were all back there. It's just like a movie. They took the coats off, and ate sweet corn dripping with butter and salt and pepper and a big steak. And that's how we did business.
Wow. Now, were the two of you too young to work in the plant at all at any point in time, whether, during the time of the Grigg? It's
What does this mean?
Les is, yeah, Les is like, either don't say anything or no. Or I want to tell it's.
I want to chime in here. So the Burley plant in 1959, they expanded in Burley, Idaho, and built a new plant. That's where my father was hired. He became the cost accountant that built that plant. And so we moved to Burley. And in the fourth grade, my first real job was going out to the Burley plant every day with my mother. And we would stock the vending machine. In fact, our basement was where we stored all the vending machine food.
Oh. Yum.
Boy, I would be snacking all the time.
I never worked. I have five older sisters, and a lot of them worked not in the plant, but they had a concession stand sort of there on the property when the and when the shifts would change, they would be out there selling cold lemonade and candy bars and snacks and stuff. And that's what they did, but I never got involved with that. It was only later, every now and then. See, Les mentioned the Burley plant, and he mentioned Otis Williams. Otis was my uncle-in-law, and you know, he modified a lot of equipment that was out there, like, you know, picking fruit and prunes and things off of bushes and trees. And he modified that somehow to make, you know, become the tater tot. And so we were, and he lived in Burley, and he ran the Burley, he was president of the Burley plant. And so we would go back and forth to Burley, and I got really close with a first cousin, a son of Otis, Mischief. They would send us down into the spud cellars. You know, the potatoes keep very well if you keep them cooled. And they had these football length spud cellars that were below ground and full of potatoes. And they had air ducts that would come down. They would draw air in and cool the potatoes from underneath. But as you cleared out a spud cellar, they'd be full of mud. And so they would pay us exorbitant fees to go down there and pound out the mud from those ventilation holes. But other than that, I never really worked as an Orwright employee. Too young.
That's right. We're not old.
No, not now.
No. You're right.
I was born in 52.
Oh yeah, you're just babies. You couldn't really work.
So. No, I mean, tater tots were born in 53, and I was born in 54. And by the time they, you know, in 65, when they sold it, I was what? 11. I was 11, but I sure enjoyed the benefits of being there. I have a clear memory in my mind of my dad taking us out. He, again, this whole sense of community, he would go out into the production lines of the French fries and just be seen. He would go out there and he knew the people's first names and, you know, how's it going, and just to keep in touch. And he would reach up, he kept a salt shaker in his jacket pocket, and we'd go out there and he would scoop up great big hands of French fries as they were coming off the cooling line and put salt on them. And I'll tell you what, that is, there's nothing like that. Nothing at all like that. And so that's a memory of the plant.
So back, I would imagine, on task, your question about our legacy. I grew up with this legacy, and throughout my business career, I would go to, I'd use that to try to connect to farmers. You know, socially, I go out to farmers and they say, the reason you ought to do business with me as a stockbroker is because my family invented the tater tot. That never went anywhere. But just as time has come on, and the other thing that I think is driving this legacy issue is one of the things that we do very prolifically, and I wouldn't say it's strictly LDS culture, but it's big in LDS culture, and that's family history. Family history, family legacies, family reunions, big part of our culture. And as time has grown on, I have had just a number of events happen. I think in 2018, like I say, I got a call from CBS Sunday Morning Magazine one day, and they wanted some help to figure out how to get enough history to produce a 20-minute segment on the tater tot, and they wanted our help to help them with some Sigma. So I got a hold of Steve, and I got a hold of Gary Grigg. That's Golden's oldest son, and Steve's sister got involved, and we put together a package of information that went to CBS, and they produced this segment. Well, Steve and I, we kind of both were on the same wavelength, and between 2018 and 2020, we both decided that something had to be done with that holy board, it was an injustice to the story of the tater tot, to the success story, to have this holy board secreted in a private place where nobody could ever see it. And that's kind of been our mantra for the last 2 years. And then in January of 2022, Heinz decided to sell the plant to J.R. Simplot Corporation. And about 6 months after that, I got this idea. I'm going to contact J.R. Simplot and just try to get something done about the holy board. So I wrote a letter to them, and they got back to me. And that has kind of been the catalyst, if we will, to bring us where we are today for the last 3 months. We've been on this mission to work with J.R. Simplot, have their permission of Heinz Corporation, to see what we can do to carry on this story, carry on this legacy, so that it gets the proper attention.
Yeah. Well, ultimately, I would like to see the because the foundation's in its infancy, I would like to see it somehow, you know, give back from the legacy, because I won't always be here, and Les won't always be here. So there is that, you know, wanting to carry it forward past this sort of, what's the word, range of remembrance, because my children are now going to be, you know, another generation removed, and I want to make sure that they know the story. In fact, I read a story on the internet that said that tater tots were an accident, you know, from a mess up on the production line. And I wrote a very nice letter to the author of the article, as you know, pointing out the correction, the correct story of the tater tot. They were excited. They were excited to have the correct story. And so that's the kind of thing, even though it seems self-serving, there is a side of the foundation that wants to keep the story, you know, straight and pure.
Sure. I mean, that's understandable to me, because with that Seattle thing, you know, how did that start? Where did it start? How many people think that it started in Seattle? So I would see exactly why the Grigg Foundation is going to want to set the record straight and keep the story in line with what are facts, instead of it being a mistake. No, this is how
Chuck, we do. You're our number one evangelist. Now you can, when anybody asks you, where did tater tots come from? You can say, ah. Well, it wasn't Seattle, I can tell you that.
Yeah. You know, I'm thinking a step further. I'm thinking for the advertising marketing guy here, you need to put a little history blurb on napkins, so at restaurants, when they order the tater tots, they'll look, go, oh, all right, I get it. Because I'll bet you 50% of the population really don't know Ida. Oregon, Idaho, and when they're looking at the logo, they don't realize it's Oregon, Idaho.
You know, I don't know, but I do know that the word, this is something else that we're dealing with, not only Les and I, but also back to Kraft Heinz and Simplot, is that tater tots has become a household term. You know, if you like, right?
Kleenex, Band-Aids, tissues, yeah.
Kleenex. Hand me a Kleenex. Let's eat tater tots. So there's no way we can really, there's nothing we can do about that.
Yeah.
And in a certain aspect, Les and I have resigned ourselves that any reference to tater tots is, you know, that's good PR. No bad PR. Tater tots is tater tots. But any way we can help people understand that Ore-Ida was the original tater tot, you know, we think that's in our best interest. And we, like, I go to, I ride a motorcycle from Utah to South Dakota for the Sturgis Black Hills Rally.
Right.
And I know all the restaurants along the way that serve tater tots. And when I go to these
when I go to them, I've asked. I haven't always been granted access, but I said, "Can I see the box these came in? And I want to see if it said Orida." But they usually don't let me back there, and so who knows? They could be, you know, Simplot produces Tater gems, but nobody can produce Orida Tater Tots.
I'll tell you one thing. The best tater tots around in my area come from this vegan restaurant called Bayside Grill in Everett, Washington. And there's a shout out to those guys. They make it the best, very crispy. So this is going to lead me to ask, Steve, Les, if you went to a restaurant and you ordered tots, tater tots, and they said, oh, by the way, we had to substitute. We don't have Orida. Thumbs down for Steve.
No. I'd be willing to give it a try.
I've succumbed to it in the past. I've just had them because I like them, and I wasn't that committed to the brand, but I still think it's the best brand.
That gets two thumbs down from me, then.
You know what? There is something about the Orida, the brand. It seems like it comes out either, I don't know, I can't say crispier, or the way the things are cut, all the pieces are fitting together, the form, that there's something different about it, because I've tried some of these other brands, and maybe it's a mental thing, but I always come back to the brand Orida. And
but where there, your are folks started. There are a few businesses around town that serve some version of tater tots, but I won't go there to eat them because they're just not good.
Well, right.
It depends on how you prepare them. Okay. Chuck, you mentioned the crispiness. The best way, of course, back then, all there was deep frying. Mm-hmm. And I think the best tots are deep fried. Now, it's not the healthiest, but it's how they first came about. And I think that crispiness, that crunch is what makes them, you know, a great tater tot. I mean, even Orida tater tots in the oven, unless you cook them at a real high temperature and crisp them up, they got to be crispy.
All right, so here's a question for you, both of you. What do you think about using it in an air fryer?
Oh.
I love an air fryer.
Me
air
too.
Air fryer, good. Uh-huh.
I love
air fryers.
Yeah,
yes, it works. Does.
Takes a little experimenting, but you can get a good, a little bit healthier in an air fryer.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. In fact, I'm not kidding. So before I came out to sit down and speak with you gentlemen, I opened my freezer to make sure I had some in there. I did.
We'll send you some coupons.
Careful, you're on air. So they're sitting alongside of my onion rings in there. So, but they're a different brand.
And that's okay. Well, here's the thing. You know, anybody can make French fries. Anybody can make onion rings, hash browns, all those things. But only Orida has, you know, came up with the tater tot. So it was an ingenious new food. I think J.R. Simplot is interested in that. It's a formed food. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a food that is formed and then sold that way. It's not something, unless you're crazy like Les and you try to make your own tater tots. it's not a, you know, it's difficult to make. I've seen a lot of videos. People have come up with some ingenious ways of trying to make little cylinders. But I tell you, those tater tots are unique and special.
Yeah, you put it really good at the very beginning when you said that coming up with a finger food. So that, it's a perfect finger food. Same way with the little pocket pizza things or whatever, those tiny pizza rolls.
Oh, pizza rolls, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a little
but
finger
again,
food.
But again, anybody can make a pizza roll.
But you know what? They really could, and you're right. Who's going to sit here and want to chop up a perfectly good potato or french fry and then try to form their own tater tot?
Les,
you can do that. Yeah. Not me. So do you have kids? Do you have grandkids right now?
I do, yes.
Less, yeah, grandkids.
13.
So, how many?
13.
13 years old or 13?
Grandchildren. 13 grandchildren.
Woo! I had to get that clear because if you said 13, I'm going, no, it can't be 13 of them. But then Les, like, or Steve, like you said, you came from a family of eight. So.
Well, so I myself only have, I only have 13 grandkids as well. But you think about my parents, Nephi and Addie, they came up, they had 49 grandkids and twice that many great grandkids. My wow. My oldest sister, who just passed away this year, had well over 100 grandkids. She had 9 kids. So anyway, that family culture, I think, was very much a part of Orida, that, mm-hmm. that close-knit thing, like you mentioned before, Chuck.
Les, I wanted to ask you, with your grandkids, even your kids, is this something mm-hmm. that's important that they talk to you about? Say, you know,
yes,
you know, Dad, both. Grandpa, you know, tell me about the history.
Yeah. One of the things I've just started is a Grandchild of the Month program so I can connect with my grandchildren. And my oldest grandson has helped me design a web page for that project. It's called Grandchild of the Month. And so we are using this legacy as part of that story, and we've created a website called the griggtatertot.org, and I'm going to use that to help carry the legacy on with my grandchildren.
Mm. You know, forget about the family tree. There's going to be a family potato field, and you just scan potato heads and names. That's what I see. From either one of you, is there anything that the general populace can do to help perpetuate this or to help you further along with this journey that that you're on, Les, and you, Steve, as well?
We're working on a website to for the foundation. We do have a domain secured. It's a griggtatertot.com. And I've been working this last week with trying to find an avenue to where we can design a website and get that going. And so that's a work in progress.
You'd think I would do that. But...
Family. Sometimes they're no good for nothing.
I'm old school. Websites scare me.
Gentlemen, I've really enjoyed this conversation, and I have learned a few new things about the brand, about the legacy, which has brought more interest to me, actually, to really personally read up about it. So, and I'll be reaching out to you for some stock and financial advice later, and whenever I'm going to be rebranding, so I can hit Steve up.
There you go.
Oh. And I'm glad to pay you with some shares of stock. But not in perpetuity.
You know, my one story that you might be interested in, Chuck, is how Tater Tots got outside the region.
Yes.
So in my there's an annual list. Did we ever decide what the
we don't know if it was a food distributor or a potato convention in Miami. It's one of the two.
Anyway, so my, you know, they wanted exposure cross country. And so my dad packed up 15 pounds of tater tots in dry ice in a suitcase. You could do that back then, in a suitcase. Got on a plane, flew to Miami where this conference was taking place. And with the help of a crisp $100 bill, he got his he made his way into the chef, and so people got to eat, and so he arranged for those tater tots to be cooked up, and during their lunch break, or maybe it was a breakfast break, I can't remember, it was a food break, he arranged to have little plates of tater tots put on the tables of all, you know, throughout the cafeteria area. Now you can imagine, no one had ever seen those before, never even heard of them. You know, my dad liked to make funny phrases, and he said those are gobbled up faster than a dead cat could wag its tail. which I don't know what that means. Yeah. But it's quoted in the Annals of History. That's what he said. But you know, that got Tater Tots, or Ride a Tater Tots, cross country in a kind of memorable way.
Wow. That's pretty amazing. So yeah, I'm glad you put that in there. gee, I'm sorry. I'm just thinking back to about your dad carrying the salt in his pocket and everything, walking through the plant. I was thinking, you know, Heinz is a perfect marriage because I can see now you got the little packets of ketchup with you as well.
I made a tater tot outfit. They've started a tater tot festival in Ontario. They had the second annual last year, and I made up a tater tot costume, and before I went to this tater tot festival, at my work there was a Halloween costume party, and I dressed up as a tater tot. Instead of handing out candy, I handed out packets of ketchup.
Are you kidding?
I'm not kidding. I really did. The company was really big on Halloween, and nobody knew what to make of me.
Again, Les and Steve, I've really enjoyed this. This has been great, and thank you very much for your time. And
thanks,
like I said,
for your invite.
Like I said, I'm really going to read more about your family and about Tater Tots and about Orida. So you've done your job.
Thank you. We're doing our best to get the truth out there. The truth is out there, as the movie says.
Anyhow, that's it. That's a wrap. I hope you enjoyed this podcast because I certainly did. I mean, I learned a lot from both Steve and Leslie about Orida and about Tater Tots. So a special thanks one more time to Steve and Leslie. And thanks to all of you for continuing to come back and support this channel, because without you, it really would not be going anywhere. So please remember to like, comment, and share this and all the podcasts. It really does help with whatever those algorithms are out there, which allow more people to find this channel. And remember, this is amazing people, amazing things. So if you have a story to tell, or if you want somebody to share, or if you know somebody that has something to talk about, please reach out and let me know. But until next time, when you go into that restaurant and they give you the option between fries and tots, what are you going to get? Tots. Have a great day. Bye-bye.